Hi guys, this is Steve Angello. You're watching Brandnite TV.
Hi everybody, welcome to a new episode of Brandnite TV. I'm your host Philip, and tonight we have one of the biggest idols of the EDM scene today. It's Steve Angello. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Hi. It's not the first time that you're in Vienna, actually.
No.
You've been here at the Beatpatrol a couple of times, at Volksgarten in Vienna.
Yeah, I've been here many times over the years.
I think the first time you've been here was a couple of years ago when Axwell played at Volksgarten, and you've been here as a guest, is that
yeah.
right?
Yeah. When was that? That was, must have been like...
2007 or 2008 or something.
Oh, earlier.
Earlier?
Yeah.
I think that was when he had the Feel the Vibe kind of track out. When was that?
2007?
Yeah, something like that.
For this interview, I didn't think about questions because I thought I'm going to make a poll on the internet again on Twitter and Facebook and let all your fans that don't have the possibility to talk to you ever
sure.
decide what I'm going to ask you. So I'm just going to tell you, ask you kind of the most rated questions.
Sure.
One of the most asked questions was, is there any new Mescal Kid stuff coming out now after the split of the Swedish House Mafia?
Loads. There's a lot of music coming out. I'm doing my solo album right now, and I've done a lot of Mescal Kid stuff. So there's a lot of music coming, you know. I have a lot of time, and, you know, I have a clear schedule. So
a lot of time, even though you have two kids now?
Yeah, but they're supportive, you know. They understand when daddy goes to work and they leave me in the studio and, you know, cool. they'll get it.
Is it true that you got the name Mescal Kid from Felix the House Kid because of his habit yeah. With drinking mescal tequila all the time?
Yes, that's true. I've known Felix for so many years, and I think he called me Mescal Kid because I was drinking mescal with him. And then since that day, I just kept it and, you know... It's a little fun name.
When you start doing tracks, at which point do you decide that it is a Steve Angello track or a Mescal Kid track?
Before I start the track. You know, I'm a little bit different when it comes to that because I need to have a vision before I even get into the studio. So I can be home for 1 month and not go to the studio once.
Really?
Yeah, because I'm gathering all this information. And then I go into the studio for a week and then I can make 10 records. You know, so I need, there's so much creativity that I have to gather to be able to make music. You know, I have to, for example, for my album, I had to get the artwork finished before I started the music.
Okay.
Because I needed a direction visually, you know, so I'm kind of weird with that kind of stuff.
So where does the inspiration come from? What is the difference between the inspiration for a Mescal Kid track or a Steve Angello track? What's the difference in getting started?
I think the difference is Mescal Kid is very club driven. You know, it reminds me of when I fell in love with house and tech house and deep house. You know, back in late 90s, it reminds me of the dark little rooms, you know, with great sound system and sweat pouring down the walls, you know. Mescal Kid is a little darker and more techy and beat driven, whereas the Steve Angello album it's an artist album. I've been able to work with some of the most amazing artists that exist, and it's just very it's a soundtrack of my life, you know. It's a lot of live instruments. I've worked with string quartets, I've worked with kids choirs, I've worked with amazing guitarists and bass players, and
I'm kind of jealous, I have to admit.
You know, I've always been a really big fan of music as just music, you know, everything from movie soundtracks, you know, movie scores to heavy metal, you know. So I think that the album is a soundtrack of where my head's at now and my journey to this point.
You just mentioned the small intimate clubs with sweat and like only a stroboscope and some dust
if
machines and everything.
If even that, you know. Yeah. Like I remember a couple of clubs that I used to play. I remember a club called Yellow that was in Tokyo. And it was all about sound system, you know. Like they didn't care about lights. There was no LED. There was no screens. There were no lasers.
But do you, you know, you're traveling from country to country, continent to continent, playing these big ass shows with 20,000 people and more. Yeah. But you'd also do some kind of after show parties to stay in the club. But they're also big clubs, you know.
Yeah.
Don't you miss the really small, intimate? Like for example, Loco Dice did this. I think it was called 300 Tour, but they played 13 cities with clubs with only 300 people in there.
That would be great.
Did you think about doing something like that?
I wanted to do a tour, now when Size became 10 years old, I wanted to do a tour where we used to do the first Size parties. Mm-hmm. But a lot of those clubs doesn't exist today, you know. So I wanted to go back and really do where we started. You know, I wanted to go to like tiniest little places. But it's just hard for me, you know, because, you know, there's all these festivals, there's all these things, and you know, usually you get an idea and you want to do it now, but then you're already booked, so you got to push it and push it. So it's still on my bucket list, you know.
Okay, so the next time you're in Vienna and playing a festival, let me know about it. I'm going to do the after show party with 300 people only.
100%.
You also just mentioned the movie score. So yeah. If there would be one director or movie that you would love to do the score for, who would that be?
That's a tough question. I think that it depends. You know, it depends on the mood. And, you know, I like movies when they're very indie and very different without big studio budgets. And I like a movie when it comes out from nothing, not when it's a planned success, you know. So it's really hard. You know, there's a lot of young guys coming up now, and there's always a lot of talented people. And since I moved to LA and I spent winters there for the past 5-6 years, I've met a lot of these people, and I've seen a lot of stuff when it's very early. And then I see them go and win the awards, and then I see it become a big, you know. So I'm very lucky to be involved with a lot of creative people, so I get to see a lot of these things very early, you know.
Talking about creative people, you discovered such talent as Third Party, Q Lines, of course, your brother Antoine. When you're going through demo tracks, that's one of the questions that everybody told me, please ask Steve Angello this question. When you're going through demos, what is the most important thing for you to really take notice of a good track? Is it the creativity or is it the sound quality? Because you know, a lot of young producers are really creative, but they have not that skills and experience when it comes to audio engineering. So what is the most important thing for you?
It doesn't really matter to me about sound quality, because I probably mixed, I would say, 85% of the records coming out on Size. Mm-hmm. I've mixed all of them. So it doesn't really matter, as long as there's something there, something creative, something that I feel that this is okay, this is like, this part is amazing. And then we go back and we change, and then, you know, I'll make it sound good, and then we're good to go, you know. So it's not about sound quality as much as a lot of guys need to learn to put more time into tracks and appreciate dynamics, you know. A lot of stuff sounds exactly the same today just because there's no mix trick. Mm-hmm. Why records sounded different back in the days was because the mix engineer, he had a very special feel to the Quincy Jones records compared to, you know. So nobody really knows, nobody has their sound anymore. It kind of sounds all the same. Anybody, any track could be anybody. So I think that sometimes you get those records that really stick out sonically and that you can hear, okay, this is different, you know. It's like when I got the Atom record by Nori and Milani. When I first heard it, I'm like, this is different. This is going to change stuff, because the way the breakdown, very big chords and trancy, then the drop into this very monotone kick and bass, you know. And then I've heard like 1 million records after that that sounded exactly the same, you know. So when there is one of those records, the rest will follow, you know. So be that guy, do that record, you know.
So I just wanted to ask you what advice you would give young bedroom producers, but actually that was the advice, so I can skip to the next question then.
You know, there's no rush. There's no time schedule, there's no deadline, there's no... Nobody's knocking your door asking for records. You know, take your time, make sure that it's where you want it to be, not just send it out and be like, okay, this is done. Because, you know, if you would put twice as much time into a record, it would probably be twice as good.
Do you think, you know, there has been a lot of discussion on the internet when you released Knas because of the bass line being Vengeance Soundtrack. Do you think that maybe you as an idol, as you are for a lot of kids and young producers out there, do you think that taking a bass line from a Vengeance sample CD has... put or has shown young producers kind of the wrong directions, not to make their own sounds, but, you know, just go through sample CDs and take whatever they like to hear?
No, I don't think so. It's like when I go and listen to a Daft Punk record, you know, and I hear a sample that's straight a disco beat that they chopped in 8 bars and then they loop it and then they have an effects and a kick drum. It's exactly the same thing. So, no, I don't think so. I think that if you find something that inspires you to create something that can be workable, I think you should do it. I found something that I felt like, okay, I can change this and I can make this really, really big. So I did it, you know? It's I've still done 400 other records that I haven't done that with. So I think it's like, it doesn't really, I don't give it justice, but if it's there to sample,
take it,
enjoy it. You know, it's like, it's disco samples. It's like chords, guitars. Almost all the music we do today is inspired by something, you know. So it's like all my idols, it was all based on samples when I grew up, you know. So I don't feel I could sample that.
No, when I'm before we met today, I watched a lot of interviews, and I think there's one topic that people ask you way too less about, and it's the Size Foundation, because you're really productive charity-wise.
Yeah.
So what is for people that don't know about the Size Foundation, what is it like in very short words?
We have orphanages in India. We take care. We house kids that has nowhere to go, nowhere to live, no food to eat. We give them education so they can work and make money. We teach them about anything that a kid should be taught. We put them through school until they graduated. We help them from the street to the business life and give them a life to live, you know. We have 135 kids that we take care of right now. It's growing. We're opening a school. I'm joining another group and helping them in Africa. We're doing a couple of things in Sweden. There's a couple of charities in America that we're helping. So, you know, Size Foundation has grown very organically, and it's nothing I want to go out with a big sign and say, here, donate money, you know. It's something I've grown from the grassroots, and it's something that I believe in very strongly. So, you know, we're just helping out. You know, I think that a lot of people should help if they can, because a lot of people need help.
That's true.
So as the final question, you're now touring with the Size Matters stage on various festivals with the likes of, like I said before, third-party queue lines, Antoine, Max Vangeli, etc. What's coming up next from yourself, except the album that you just mentioned before? What can people see on Ibiza, for example, because you don't do Mondays at Pasha anymore?
No, I mean, I had a chance of doing Ibiza this year, but I just felt that there was so many other places I wanted to be, you know. I can't, if I'm committed to do something every week, I have to cut a lot of other stuff, you know. And I just want to have fun now and do things that I really enjoy. And I don't want to feel like I'm doing something just because I signed up for it. I want to go and do all the festivals. I want to travel around the world. And, you know, I just want to have fun. And I'll be in Ibiza, for sure.
I think.
Yeah, it was just on Data Now. Space and Amnesia, and I'm doing Pasha. And I think I'll do 4 or 5 shows in Ibiza by the end of the summer.
Cool. So thank you for your time.
Thank you.
And please don't forget about the private intimate party we're doing after your next festival gig in Austria.
I'm there.
I'm gonna remind you on Twitter.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you for the time. See you soon.
Appreciate it. Bye.